यस
यस
मैम।
मैम।
ओके सो टुडे वी विल ट्राई टू सी द इफेक्ट ऑफ फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी ऑन टेस्ट एरर ट्रेनिंग एरर। वी हैव सीन इन वन ऑफ द लेक्चर्स दैट व्हाट हैपेंस टू ट्रेनिंग एरर एंड टेस्ट एरर एज यू इंक्रीज फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी ऑफ द मॉडल। यस If you increase flexibility of the model, what happens to the training error or the test error?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes. Training error will decrease and
test error will increase.
Test error will increase. Okay. So let us try to see if that really happens. Okay, I mean in theory it is supposed to happen, but we'll try to see if that really happens. So just wait, I'll try to share my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, let me take again some random observations. So, let me take say again 100 observations. And let us try to simulate from a quadratic model. So let us try to simulate from a quadratic model. So y equal to b naught plus b1 into x plus b2 into x square, and of course epsilon has to be there. So plus r norm n. Let me again generate from standard normal the errors. So r norm n. Okay. Right now we won't do cross validation. First we will just have training set, test set, and we'll try to compute training error and test error. Okay, so I'll divide my data into two equal parts. So let and anyway I've taken randomly, so I can take my training set as first 50 observations. So dbc data is my c bind x comma y, and training set let it be first 50 values. Okay, let this be my training set. So the remaining part is test set. So test set is D. I have to start by floor of n by 2 plus 1. N. Okay, this is my test set. Now we will try to fit models of different order. How do you fit a polynomial regression model?
I'm LN.
LM.
LM. Y tilde. X square.
I don't want just x square. I want x plus x square.
Ma'am, it will. Okay.
Let me see.
X square will do y.
No, it didn't do. It gave me only one coefficient.
Okay, then x plus x square. I think it will get.
It still didn't work. It gave me exactly same output. Others?
Ma'am, we can store x squared in one variable, then we can do it.
Others are also allowed to talk, by the way. Any suggestions?
Ma'am, we can...
Sorry? Someone was saying something?
Can we use GLM?
But then GLM will go for... which link function would you use?
Identity link.
Identity, okay.
One simple thing we can do is that we can store a 1z column in that CY, in that data set. And then we can do simply like y tilde x plus z.
By the way, I did not ask for quadratic. I asked for polynomials. I want to generalize this finally till x raised to 10 maybe. So whenever you are saying something, keep in mind that it has to be generalizable. Okay, this worked. For GLM, what is the function to give link? I mean, what is the argument to give link function? I was forgotten.
Ma'am, it will be family will be Gaussian, and within that Gaussian, link equals to identity.
Okay. Family Gaussian, and then as a control parameter, I should give link.
Yes.
Family equal to Gaussian, and then
link argument.
No, it doesn't work.
Ma'am, actually, it will not under the codes. The codes will be removed. The Gaussian codes. Gaussian codes must not be there.
No. Codes, I think, will be there.
No, ma'am. It will be acting like a function. Yes. Just make a first bracket beside Gaussian.
This is what you mean?
Yes, ma'am. That another thing, ma'am. The link equals to before identity. Link equals to.
Okay.
And yes.
That also didn't work.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah. Whoever suggests
this...
LM. Wait. Whoever suggested GLM, that also did not work. It again took only x. It did not take x square. Yes, next.
Ma'am, with LM command. So, we could go for y tilde x plus I bracketed x to the power 2.
Correct. LM y tilde x plus I x square, yes. So this will give you same thing that we achieved via z. Okay, but now I want this to be generalizable. I want this to go till 10 raised, x raised to 10. So how should it work? What should I do? I am too lazy to type the same line 10 times. Not same line, actually I'll have to add one term every time. So when I go for cubic, I would have to write x plus ix square plus ix cube.
And ma'am, we could use a poly command over here then.
Exactly.
Y tilde.
So I was expecting this as the first answer. Poly y tilde.
Y tilde would be outside. LM y tilde poly.
LM
yes.
Y tilde
poly x comma then whatever is the number, so you could go for 10 over here.
Now this is interesting. Why did I get a different output?
Ma'am, there's one more argument over here, like raw equals to true, you have to give it, I suppose.
for
otherwise it would after 2 go for raw equals to true.
What does it do?
It's supposed to take the variables as it is, and now you will get the same variables.
Correct. And what was happening here? Why did I get different values?
I'm not sure about that, but I knew that raw takes the variables as it is.
So what does this take? Others, you have studied a course on regression, right?
Yes, ma'am.
You have done regression practicals. So you are not supposed to forget things so soon. What happens here? Any guesses?
Ma'am, it could use orthogonal polynomials instead.
Okay, okay. What about others? He's right. Okay. If it is true, it uses raw. Otherwise, it uses orthogonal polynomials. Okay. So, right now, we don't want orthogonal polynomials. So, let me take this because this is most easily generalizable when I want to go till 10th order. Okay. By the way, in GLM also, if I do ix square, it would work. Okay. Yes. So, let me take f as the flexibility. So, I want to go till f equal to 10. So, for I in 1 to f, what I'll do every time is, I'll fit a model and I have to record training error and test error. Correct? Okay. So let me write first L equal to LM Y tilde poly X I raw equal to true. Okay, does it work for linear? Has anyone tried? See, I always tell people you are supposed to be playing with R, then only you will get comfortable. Not just R, any programming language, any software, unless you explore it from all the direction, unless you make 100 mistakes, you are not going to get comfortable with that software or that programming language. Okay, you are supposed to try everything. It doesn't have to be a predefined exercise when you open R and do that exercise and then close R. Whenever you have time, you should open R, try to do something, random things, so that you know you increase your comfort level with that software. Okay, so for linear also it worked. Okay, so it will work fine. Now training error I can get quite easily, that is not an issue. So train error at I, so I'll create two blank vectors, one for train error, one for test error. Train error and test error. So train error I will be L dollar residuals and then square of the mean and square and mean. So mean of this square. This is my mean squared error for the training data. How do I get the test error? Now yesterday when it was simple linear regression, we simply extracted the coefficients and wrote down the equation. What should I do here? Now it's a polynomial equation. Yes. And by the way, I should not use original XY because I want to use test data and train data. So I have to use train data here. So I should write train 2, or should I do something else so that it is generalizable to prediction? Come on.
And in that case, we can anyway. Ma'am, in that case, we can pass the data command in that case.
Correct.
If you are using, yes.
Correct. So I use y x and then I give
data equals to j
equal to train. Correct.
Train. Yeah.
Sorry. Data must be data frame, not a matrix or an array. So I'll need to convert it to a data frame. So that I can do here. Train equal to. Should I do it here itself? As dot data dot frame. See, I could actually write the codes on my own and share the codes with you directly. But I'm trying to write the codes here so that you know what all possible mistakes can be there. So that in exam you don't panic. By the way, in in data mining, exams are not necessarily purely theory exams. I could ask you to write R codes in exam. I don't know whether I mentioned this in the first lecture, but I have some exams. In fact, I think last batch also I had one or two class tests which were completely based on R. Okay. So that could be there. So it is very essential that you get comfortable with whatever you are doing. Okay. And that's why I write codes here so that, you know, you can see that anyone can make mistakes, and just because you see red letters over here doesn't mean you should panic. Okay. You can fix those errors if you are patiently and calmly dealing with the things. Okay.
We can pass that predict function within that L and test dataset.
So test error at I, for that I need predictions. So let me first take predictions. Suppose P is predict L data equal to now test, correct? New data, I think. Argument may be new data. Let me check. You did not use predict command so far? Wow, it doesn't even give. Okay, let me see whether the predictions seem all right. So anyway, this is linear regression, so I can try prediction for first observation. So L dollar coefficients 1 plus L dollar coefficients 2 into test 1, correct? This will give me predictions by formula. So we'll try to see if they match. So let me see summary of P minus P2. They're not matching. So let me try new data.
Ma'am, we don't need to give Y for prediction.
I did not give Y for prediction. It does not take Y. But if I give only the first thing, if I give only the first column, then also it would make mistake, because it needs the column names of both the data frames to be matching, train data and test data. See, once I give new data, now the predictions are correct. Can you see the summary?
Yes, ma'am.
So that problem was with the argument data. Data argument doesn't work. It has to be new data. Okay. So now test error would be, so P2 I don't need. Test error would be mean of P minus test 2 square. Correct? Is it okay so far? Everyone is getting what is happening over here?
Yes, ma'am.
Someone other than those who have spoken already in the class. Are you getting what is happening?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Let us see now what happens. Does it work? Oh. Train. I forgot the R. Okay. Now let us plot 1 to F. Train air. And let us try to join them with a line. Okay, you can see the error is very low after the second order itself, because second was the correct order, right? So after that, error is perfectly zero. Is there some problem? Let me see summary of train error. It is not perfectly zero, but it is very close to zero. Okay. It's very close to zero because we are trying to approximate a quadratic model by, say, higher order model. And let us now plot test error. Let me plot only from second point onwards, because first error is too high, so that is actually masking the effect of other values. Are you getting my point? For linear model, value of the error is too high, even for training error and for test error. So because of that, the graph is not clearly visible. So let me try to plot for the remaining points, means except for the linear model. Can you see now that the test error has increased after a certain point? We discussed this, that the test error is generally U-shaped. Now here for 10th degree model, things are getting a bit strange. But you can see here that the test error is increasing. Whereas training error will go on decreasing. It won't increase. See. Training error is decreasing. Okay, either it remains constant or it decreases. Whereas test error can increase if you are fitting a too flexible model. That's what we discussed when we studied model flexibility. If you have a model which is too flexible, it actually means that you are overfitting. Correct? You are overfitting. And as a result, your training error would go on reducing, but then your test error would go on increasing, because your overfitted model will not work well as far as predictions are concerned. Okay, so far?
Yes, ma'am.
Similar thing can be observed if we go for cross-validated error or jackknife error, etc. Okay. So, cross-validation anyway we have seen yesterday. So, today let me try to do jackknife. Let us try on the same data. Okay. So, instead of having trained data and test data as 50-50%, now my trained data would be consisting of n minus 1 observations. And test data n minus 1 observations, and test data would consist of only one observation. Okay. And my final training error would be average error over all possible training sets. And final test error would be average error over all n observations when they are kept aside for predictions. Is it okay? Yesterday I have uploaded lecture number 15 and I don't remember whether I mentioned in the description of that file, probably I did not mention, but even if you have attended my live lecture on comparison of cross-validation approaches, like comparison of K-fold with jackknife and K-fold with train validation approach, I would still say do listen to the recorded lecture, because I have tried to explain things in more detail by actually working out the mathematical equations. Okay, so do listen to lecture number 15 even if you have attended the live lecture on Saturday. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let us try to do jackknife here on the same data. So every time my train set test set would change, and I'll have to take average over all training errors and average over all testing errors. So I won't define train test here, that would go inside the bracket. So I will have another loop for that loop will be for taking every observation aside. So for J in 1 to N, for that particular flexibility, training data would be everything except jth observation, and test data would be just the jth observation. Okay. And we will have to store error for every J and then take mean. I hope it is clear whatever I am doing here. Okay, if it is not clear, please feel free to stop me and ask me what is happening. Here actually I am going to have only one observation in the test data, so I don't need to take mean. I will simply take square at this point, and then outside it is going to be mean of train error vec and mean of test error vec. And I'll need to redefine these to be blank every time. So train error vec and test error vec are blank. Okay, is it okay? Is my code okay? So what I have done here, I have first created train error vector and test error vector to store train and test error for every iteration of jackknife. You know, jackknife has to be repeated n times, and your final training error is average over all those n iterations, and final test error is again average over all those n iterations. Every time you keep one observation aside. So I have created blank vectors to store train error and test error so that later we can take mean. Then every time I construct train data by removing that particular observation, so J in 1 to N, and then test data by considering only that observation. Okay, whether it is going to work or not, we will see. We'll run for J equal to 1 only first. And if it works, then we'll go further. Then train error J. Okay, this I need to delete.
Also that train error vec wala jo row hai. I think it won't be that mean.
Why won't it be a mean?
Because the mean has been defined in the outer loop, right?
But training data itself has n minus 1 observations. So I'll have n minus 1 residuals here. So if I want to, so I would need that, I mean, I would need double mean. Here I don't need mean because test data consists of only one observation.
Okay.
Training data consists of n minus 1 observations. So first I will take mean over those n minus 1 observations over here. And my set of n minus 1 observations is changing every time. So for every set of n minus 1 observations, I'll get one value of train air wake. And then I take mean over all those values. Is it okay? Others.
Yes, ma'am.
Others.
Yes, ma'am.
Bhushan, Azhar, Dipali, Komal, are you with me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So please stop me if things are, you know, if you feel that I'm going fast or something like that. For j equal to 1 only, j equal to 1 and I equal to 1, we'll see if there is any error and then we will run for I equal to 1 and all j. And then we will run for the entire thing. So that you know if there is an error, it should be easy to locate. Okay, seems I did get some training error vector one value. Okay, and I did get some test error. Let me now try for j in 1 to n, but I equal to 1 only. Okay, so I got mean test error. Similarly, I'll have mean train error. Okay, so it seems that the loop is running peacefully. So let us try to see what happens when I run the entire thing. Okay, so let me first, let me ignore first and then see. See, again the test error has increased. Can you see roughly U shape? And what about training error? Training error is decreasing. Okay, so even by jackknife, we are getting the same conclusion that the test error increases as the model flexibility increases. Ideally, I should properly format this. My name of the x-axis should be flexibility with the correct spelling, of course. By the way, I hope you are at least comfortable with the plot command. You don't seem to be comfortable with the lm command at all. But I hope you are comfortable at least with the plot command that you must have used even in the first semester. Okay. And while I've also, I should give train error, test error, whatever. Is it okay? So the point I'm trying to emphasize here is, if you increase flexibility too much, if you fit a too complicated, too sophisticated model, then what is going to happen? You are going to overfit things to your data. And if you overfit, then of course the predictions are not going to be correct. Predictions are going to be incorrect. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
In fact, if you remember, last semester I did show you some clippings from numbers in multivariate analysis. Am I right? Does anyone remember seeing anything?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
So, in the very first episode of numbers, he is trying to model, he's trying to predict the location of attack in some serial killer is attacking women. So he's trying to predict the location of the next attack that actually turns out to be a very difficult problem. So he says that, okay, predicting location is very difficult. Why? Because he gives analogy of a fountain. So when you have a fountain and there are hundreds of factors which affect where the drops of that fountain would fall. So you can't really predict where the next drop would fall with accuracy. But if you have enough drops, you could locate the fountain. You can go back and locate the fountain easily if it is if its location is unknown. So he tries to find the location, or I mean the home or the workplace of that killer, and there he faces the same problem. So he's like, it's beginning of mathematical modeling, so he is also inexperienced, and there he faces the same problem. So he realizes that if he makes a model which is mathematically too perfect, it may not really model the real world too well. Okay, so the model is elegant, mathematically the model is beautiful, but then real world is not perfect, so you need imperfections. So same thing happens here. You may try to make train error zero, but then that would actually cause more problems, because it would be modeling errors from the real world also, which are random errors which should not be modeled, and that increases your prediction error. So we should always remember that we are not supposed to overfit. Our model should be parsimonious. Is it okay? So let me, if you don't have any doubts, let me stop here for today. If you have any doubts, we can discuss. Any doubts?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, I have one. After, actually, from these plots, we are actually managing to visualize the fact that the train error is actually decreasing, the test error, there is chance to increase, right?
Mm-hmm.
So ultimately, there must be some optimal point where we are going to stop, and for that we will be choosing that power of x, such that if we model that power of x, then the model will be more optimal model, or will be so-called more correct model.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, how we are going to choose that power, or how we are going to find that best fit model?
That's where this test error comes into picture. So the point at which test error starts increasing, that's a bad thing. So here, even though the original data comes from 2,
yes,
but still you could use model of degree 3, because in reality you would never know the actual power. So 3, 4, 5 are acceptable, but 6 is not acceptable, because now the test error has started increasing.
Ma'am, anyhow, it is actually by visualizing from a plot, isn't it a bit of subjectivity included in this?
No, not visualizing. I'm saying increasing. So you could actually see the values of test error. You can see the numbers.
Okay.
You can see the numbers are increasing now. 0.87 became 0.90. And ideally, see, this is jackknife, so it is not giving you very correct picture. If you go for k-fold cross-validation, if you go for 5-fold cross-validation, it is more likely to choose the original correct model also. So that's homework actually. Try the similar exercise with 5-fold and 10-fold cross-validation, and then see at what point test error starts increasing. And if you still want to be more sure, you could do multiple iterations of even that 5-fold or 10-fold validation, and then see roughly around what point every time the test error increases.
Okay.
So you choose
the... I think in...
You choose the model where validation error is lowest.
Okay.
In data mining, that's
validation.
You choose that point where training error or validation error... Sorry, not training error. Validation error is the least.
Okay. I got it. Ma'am, also in classical statistics, there are some means definite test procedures to detect that which coefficient is important or not, which coefficient of having power, suppose degree n, and if in that case beta n is important or not, that beta n is equals to zero or not. So ma'am, isn't it becoming still anyway just deciding from the figures?
No. Okay. Anyway, see, I got your point. See, the thing is, here you can use classical statistics. In fact, that's what I always say, you should not forget your statistics. Here you can actually use your statistics knowledge, and if you see that, okay, for third degree models, say x cube is insignificant, coefficient of x cube is insignificant, then you don't even need to worry about test error. But I did not propose that as criterion here is because right now I am talking about polynomial regression. So I have that method. But when I talk about flexibility, I am not necessarily always talking about regression. I might be talking about SVM, I might be talking about CART, I might be talking about neural networks.
Okay.
So, we do not have widely established procedures to test the significance of coefficients in those models. So okay. If you are talking only in terms of regression,
yes,
we can definitely use regression. In fact, that is going to give us more accurate answer. But here for exhibiting this easily, for illustrating this easily, I took polynomial regression. But in general, when we say flexibility, we may mean order of the tree. So should we have a tree with just, you know, two branches, or should we have a tree which has, say, 3-4 levels going one down, one below other? So when we are doing such things, unfortunately, so far we don't have widely accepted methods for testing significance at those models.
Okay. I got you. Actually, the problems will be from starting from decision trees, random forest, and
correct.
Like that. Right?
Correct. For regression, yes. Of course, statistics is going to give you a more powerful answer. And that's what I always say, don't forget you are statistics students. Use whatever statistical tools you have.
Okay, ma'am.
With you.
Okay, ma'am.
Any other doubt? Anyone else?